Okay, this is part two of applied respiratory physiology and work of breathing. We're finally going to get to the work of breathing. So the patient with the respiratory rate of 40, respiratory rate with this gas, which sucks, says, "Doc, I can't breathe." And that's completely different than won't breathe. And the only thing that I really want to know about the blood gas, honestly, acute or chronic, it doesn't matter, it's esoteric, right? Like, do it. I mean, I know if it's compensated, the pH, but when they're acidemic and their CO2's high, it's a respiratory problem. And we know, based on, it, as long as they don't have impaired ventilatory control because of obesity or narcotics, that they should not have this. And if they're working hard to defend it, to try to get the pH normal, it's that they can't breathe. But it doesn't really have anything to do with the gas exchange. And so let me tell you what I mean by that it doesn't have anything to do with the gas exchange. The reason why the person can't breathe, feels like they can't breathe, is because they have excessive work of breathing. You've heard of this term work of breathing, right? I wrote it up here, work of breathing. What is work of breathing? What does that mean? It is the physical work. What is work in physics? Yeah, it's force times distance, right?
Yeah.
Which is mass times acceleration times distance. It's some acceleration applied to a mass over a certain distance, right? So so you've heard of the term moving air. Moving air is like moving dirt or moving bricks or like moving anything else. It is a physical process. And if you can't handle the load, the workload that breathing requires to maintain a certain amount of gas exchange, which is mainly relates to CO2, not O2. This is shunting VQ mismatch. That's a different lecture. That's already belabored enough in medical school. So we're talking about moving air. So, oh no, my one balloon popped. But here, let's move that air for me. Move it. Is it hard to move that air? How hard is it to move that air? Okay. One thing about moving air, which is a physical quantity without much mass, is I want you to recognize one thing. When you move this air, when I move this, the vast majority of the mass that I'm moving is my arm. It's actually the mechanical system that I have to use to move the air. It's like a motor with a heavy piston, right? You know, idling. Most of the work that you're doing is just moving the piston. So this is called the inertial mass of the respiratory system. It's the mechanical part that I have to move. And so imagine I'm moving air, you know, in this respiratory system, and then put a 10-pound weight in there. But let's say I gained 200 pounds, and I now weigh 350 pounds. So now every time I take a deep breath in and inflate my lungs, I have to push my abdomen out of the way. That's additional inertial mass on the respiratory system. If I'm recumbent, there's even more inertial mass on the respiratory system because now it's at a worse mechanical disadvantage because now it's on this plane rather than gravitationally pulled down below. Okay, so the point is that to move air, you have to move a physical system. And if the amount that you are required to move the physical system in order to achieve normal gas exchange exceeds your capacity, then you have workload imbalance. It would be just like if I put you on a road bike and stuck you at Tanner Flats in Little Cottonwood Canyon and put you in high gear. You're not going to do it. You just don't have the strength to do that. Almost no one, unless you're a highly trained athlete, right? But people aren't training themselves to breathe. These guys have those professional rowers that have minute ventilations of 200 liters per minute. They have normal mechanics on the respiratory system, but I can mechanically disadvantage your respiratory system so that you can't move enough air to achieve normal gas exchange. And you're just as uncomfortable as you guys would be if I told you to hold your breath for 2 minutes when your CO2 got above that threshold that your ventilatory control system says, no way, no way, sucker, work harder. And then you get to a ceiling where you can't work any harder. Now you're working real hard and you're scared. And we're going to talk about the fear thing in a minute. And that's why we watched Luke Aiken skydive without a parachute and we looked at his heart rate. That's why. We're going to get to that in a second. So let's talk then about workload imbalance real quick. So this work of breathing, workload imbalance, is when is when you either do not have the strength to move the loads that are required, or the system is mechanically disadvantaged, or you just have to move a lot more air, okay? So one is gonna be no, what was the first thing I said? You don't have the strength. Two is gonna be mechanical disadvantages. And three is just gotta move a lot of air. So that's like the D, you know, force times distance or whatever, you're just doing a lot of D, okay? So let's first talk then about you're too weak. No strength, it's just gonna be weakness. So if I give you enough paralytic, your CO2 is gonna rise, right? If I give you just enough, you're not totally paralyzed. So what then are the kinds of weakness? They're always like three-letter acronyms that you're gonna find in the textbook. And what are they?
Yeah,
GBSALS, myasthenia gravis, ELS, or Eaton-Lambert system, DMD, Duchenne muscular dystrophy, all this stuff, right? Whatever, all these weakness things. Then there's drugs, certain anesthetics, or like type 1 antidysrhythmics, or a variety of things can make weakness, especially if you already have myasthenia gravis. Do you know what one of the most common ones is? LOL, little old lady. Weak, cachexic, malnourished, deconditioned, frail, so on and so forth. So this is the one, these are the textbook ones, the esoterica, which you can look up. Little old lady, or somebody that's just debilitated from cancer, end-stage disease, COPD, cardiac cachexia, all these things. And that's one of the most important things for your general and your examination is what do they look like? Do they look frail and weak? How's their grip strength? Do they have thenar wasting? Do they have temporalis wasting? You can tell just by looking at them, but it's oftentimes overlooked. So any load can be excessive for you if you're weak, all right? It's that simple. So when I look, when somebody, quote, can't breathe or the gas is all jacked up or whatever, I'm looking at them like the man to whom we discharged to hospice today, right? Part of the story to tell him and his family about why he can't breathe 30 and 40 times a minute, he's a can't breathe, is because his illness has made him weak and debilitated, especially over the last 6 months that we established. Okay, so that's weakness. Two is mechanical disadvantage. There's actually, and these are loads. These are loads on the respiratory system, excessive loads. And one, as I already told you, is inertial mass of the respiratory system. However heavy the whole system is that you have to use to move air, the harder it's gonna be to breathe to compensate for any other imposed stress. Does this all make sense? Not too technical, right? It's like common sense stuff. Okay, good. Two is a load that I'm gonna tell you is called elastic loads. And this is when the system is simply stiffer, elastance being the reciprocal of compliance, okay? So any part of the system that is not as compliant as it usually is. So look at this. Look, I'm gonna take a deep breath. And I can take a little bit more in. They call that packing. They call that air packing before they dive, by the way. And they gulp a little bit. How come I can't take this anymore? Because there's a compliance curve that you guys saw in all your, you know, classes, and we're most compliant up in here, cord compliance, and down here we're not compliant, down here we're not compliant. And the COPDers breathe up here at hyperinflation. It's not that compliant. So that's one of the mechanical disadvantages of COPD, and they start using your respiratory muscles. So they're working at an inelastic portion of their tidal inflation curve, even though their lungs are extremely floppy and elastic. They're not stiff, they're less stiff than usual, okay? So they have a different problem. They have impaired elastance, but that doesn't impair their breathing, it's the volumes at which they breathe that's impairing their breathing. So I like to think of it anywhere from the inside out. If you go over to the burn unit, you'll see these people with all these burn eschars, right, on the wall, the survivors. right? That can do it. Scleroderma can do it. Putting yourself in a TLSO brace, like I learned after a snowmobile accident in Park City. I had to get in one of these clamshell things, right? And then I walked up a couple flights of stairs like I usually do, and within a week, I'm like, God, I'm deconditioned already. No, I wasn't. I had an elastic load, and when I tried to take deeper tidal volumes as I had increased minute ventilation with exercise, I had a lag, and it made me feel uncomfortable and short of breath. So I start from the outside and I go in. Any the pleura, if you have a pleural rind, if you have pleural effusions, if you have ascites, abdominal compartment syndrome, anything that makes it harder to expand that system to its full capacity as it usually would, and down, of course, into parenchymal lung disease. Anything that makes the lungs stiffer or soggier, like, you know, edema, you know, all of that stuff, pneumonia. Any parenchymal lung disease, most parenchymal lung diseases, infiltrative lung diseases, let's just say, make the system stiffer, and that's an elastic load. It feels like you can't breathe. And the way that people compensate for that stiffness is by breathing fast in the compliant zone. If you see IPF out on the floor waiting for a lung transplant, you're gonna see respiratory rates of 50 to 60, and they're gonna be breathing in the compliant zone to minimize the elastic loads. Now, what they do then is they sacrifice another load. They're trying to compensate and breathe really fast in here at the most compliant part of the lung, but then they impose upon themselves by doing that. So, but the point is, anybody with an abnormal chest x-ray has excessive elastic loads compared to you with a normal chest x-ray. The next load, and there's another one in here called viscoelastic tissue resistance. We're not, it's esoteric, we're not gonna talk about it, it's not practical. Okay, the next one is, so this is the system stiff. This is resistive loads. Now, don't confuse this with restrictive lung disease. They're totally different words, common mistake. And this is pipes clogged. And actually, the work of an elastic system is 1/2 k, the constant x squared, which is the distance. Actually, it's just like the kinetic energy equation. It's all like physics, but we'll leave that out of there. It's like intuitively understandable. Resistive loads is the pipes are clogged. Resistance is proportional to what? The inverse of the radius to the fourth. So the airway caliber, there going down to there, it's just like the aortic valve. It's something like a square centimeter, 0.7 square centimeters. Once it gets so small, then it's hard to actually move air through that system. And that can happen in a variety of obviously intuitive ways. One is anything from the upper airway down, breathing through a straw, upper airway obstruction, glottic obstruction, post-whatever obstruction, some obstruction down here. Obliterative bronchiolitis would be a great one. COPD, where when they breathe out, because the lungs don't have normal elastance, they're not elastic enough, they're too compliant, then the airways collapse and you can't get it out. Secretions, airway edema, asthma, all of these things. Right, anything that causes the pipes to be clogged imposes a resistive load. And I'm going to show you in part three what a resistive load is and feels like to make it so you will never ever forget it. There's another thing about resistive loads. Do you remember Reynolds' number? It's between 2 and 4,000, and it's, I don't remember the equation, it doesn't matter, but it's the transition between laminar to turbulent flow. And in laminar flow, you've just got stuff moving, everything's moving along the, you know, the same way along there. And in turbulent flow, you start to get this kind of action, right? And it's only moving along because of the shear stresses and so on and so forth. There's a whole physics behind that and a whole physiology, which is actually somewhat interesting. But as you start to breathe faster, you increase resistance because of turbulent flow through any airway of any caliber. Okay, so this person here, this IPF person that's breathing 50 times a minute, they're sacrificing turbulence and increasing airway resistance to come to naturally to some middle ground where the overall work that is required to move a certain amount of air is minimized. Okay, so now let's go back to